chapters have been about history of balance, complexity, phase transitions, the slower is faster effect, fragility. This is the sixth chapter about scale-free distributions and many related phenomena. Future chapters will deal with rank dynamics, heterogeneity, evolution, philosophy, and so on. I will not be kind of telling novel things to most of you. Thank you for your patience, but I think that the exercise will be valuable if you can just think whether you would explain to a general audience in a similar or better way the concept that I'll be mentioning. So that would be very helpful. Zipf's law has become very famous. George Zipf was an American linguist, and in the 1930s, he began counting the occurrence of different words, if I'm not mistaken, in James Joyce's Ulysses. And he ranked first the most frequent word, which was the...
Is your microphone on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is this better, or... I mean, I don't have the volume here. So, I think it was James Joyce's Ulysses, and Zipf was counting the different words, how many times they occurred. So the first was the second of, the third and so on. Then in other books like the Bible, he got very similar distribution. Basically, if you plot in log-log, the x-axis, the rank of the words, or the logarithm of the ranks, the y-axis, the logarithm of the occurrences, you get something like a straight line with the exponents minus one. And this, some data from Google Books, they scanned about 4% of all books ever published. These ones are just in English for different years, and you see that they have very similar distribution. And the next chapter, I will speak about rank dynamics, so it's basically how these type of rankings change in time. And actually, Zipf was not the first to study this type of distributions. At least Stupa and Auerbach had been studying them before, since the late 19th century. But Zipf was the one who made it popular. And also, he noticed that the same distribution was followed by cities in the United States. So most populated city then, and I think still now, was New York. Then forget Chicago, Los Angeles, second and third, and so on. And
but by the same distribution, you mean with
an exponent
with a crossover between two behaviors?
Yeah, with an exponent minus one.
No, but there's two slopes on here, right? It crosses over from one thing to another.
Yeah, so I will, in the next slide, I will speak more about how good this law actually fits different distributions, because there have been many criticisms. I mean, for words, you can fit better with two different slopes, but you can fit it even better with other more complicated functions. Just to be on the same page, a distribution is basically how different values of a set occur. So you count the repetitions for a specific value or in this case, a word or a rank. If you have many of a few and few of many, then you have something like this. If you have a well-defined mean, then you will have more like a Gaussian or Poisson distribution. And we'll see more about that in a moment. Yes.
Here, the different plots, this books.
Yeah.
Up to 1700.
No. Of the year precisely 1700, and simply because there are less books published in each year. This is like non-normalized, so it's the total number of occurrences for each word of different ranks. And there you divide by the total number of words, so there is the probability, so then.
It's very interesting that they all have this, you know, kind of hump, and, you know.
Yeah, there are many things that you can notice when you go into the details, and whether different languages and how this change in time, different years, and then you can see some effects of the wars, these distributions, and that's something you can go deep into it. And already see a few years later, he proposed an explanation for this distribution using the principle of least effort, which has been used also in many other domains. I mean, as far as I understand, Einstein's general relativity can be explained with this, and also.
I don't understand what that statement means.
I
don't understand what that statement means, that Einstein.
The principle of least effort. Oh, yeah, I should have explained what does that mean. So, that in a language, in order to communicate more efficiently, basically with the least effort, then if you have such a distribution, it will be easier than if you have a more homogeneous distribution of words, because that means that you are repeating. Well, first you need to know more of a core vocabulary, and then you will be repeating words that, in a more efficient way, you repeat only few because they have a very particular meaning, and then you will be restricted by words that have a common meaning, and you would need to have different words with the same meaning because you kind of there are few meanings that are repeated constantly, and many words for which meaning it's not so frequently used. So, I mean, in general terms, the principle of least action or least effort has been used also by Feynman and others to explain different laws in physics. This was also used here. Actually,
but I think it doesn't explain laws of physics. It's a formulation of the laws of physics.
Yeah. So I mean,
which is different.
For this type of distributions, there are many mechanisms that will give you these distributions. So, of course, there have been many explanations. But then if you have different mechanisms that give you the same distribution, it's difficult to say, OK, if the real phenomena has this mechanism or not. And this has become more complicated in recent years. Well, recent years, 80s, 90s, more data became available. And then power laws began popping everywhere. And well, this is just an example of this first paper. So, I mean, here at the Institute, there has been lots of works in scaling metabolism in cities and many others. And this has, of course, relationships with complex networks, with criticality. But of course, in many cases, the fitting is, a bit stretched in the sense that it's not really a power law, or you can see that the distribution has a segment where it kind of looks like a power law, but then other regions of the distribution are different.
I realize this is just an example, but
yeah.
I'm intrigued by the fact that the religions plot has an x-axis, which includes 10 to the 9. So are there really 10 to the 9 religions?
Yeah, I don't know.
Or maybe, I don't know.
What no,
I think it's the adherence.
What's that?
There's an encyclopedia of religions.
Oh, is there?
It apparently has enough, but I think I thought it was of order thousands.
Could it be?
Rather fragmented.
Yeah.
Could it be?
Zero adherence.
Right. But if
could be the number.
Everyone has their own religion, so then it's almost 10 to the 10.
Anyway, sorry.
Could be the number of adherents of each religion. So there are a few religions with lots of people and many religions with few people.
Yeah.
Yeah, because the y-axis is the number of things. Not the x-axis.
Yeah.
What's the x-axis?
The x-axis is Carlos was saying,
in case of religions,
number of adherents. So the x-axis is the number of religions, and the y-axis the number of adherents, roughly.
Yeah. I mean, we would just need to check that paper.
Anyway, whatever. It's just a detail.
Yeah. So, I mean,
probably the number of religions is still small than languages. And actually, religious guys, you know, Catholic, they counted a number of languages, the best estimate. It's around 6,000, as far as I remember.
Similar ballpark.
There must be number of adherents, because for cities, it goes.
Yeah, similar, definitely. Almost tiny groups, they have some religions, that's true. But still a little less.
I see. Number of adherents.
Yeah.
Okay, anyways, carry on.
Yeah, so I mean, at some point, many people were like, well, so what? There's a power law. Power laws are common, or maybe not. what's the big difference? Well,
there's a selection bias that if people see some boring distribution, they don't write about it.
There's something more fundamental. If you want to use calculus, you need a well-defined mean. That's the fundamental theorem of calculus. So basically, in these skewed distributions, well, in a perfect power law, your standard deviation would tend to infinity. So basically, if you use calculus, you will get misleading results. So we can say that calculus works if we have this type of distributions. I mean, doesn't necessarily need to be Gaussian or Poisson or beta or gamma distributions. We need that there's a well-defined mean. The majority of the elements will be close to the mean. And then you can simplify. This is usually a result of additive processes in the sense that if you assume you have a random variation around the mean, then some variations will take you farther from the mean, but other variations will take you closer to the mean. So more or less, it will lead to small deviations. And of course, it's easier to study. You can simplify and let's say, okay, we'll just take the median or the mean, depending on what you're interested, and forget about the details. And actually, we can see this in terms of balance at a single scale, in the sense that, well, you have balance near the mean, and we have worked with this type of distributions for a long time. But if you, yeah.
So, and the last slide,
this one?
Yeah, so you said fundamental theorem of calculus. Did you mean mean value theorem?
What do you mean by this calculus comparison?
I mean, I wouldn't be able to. I don't remember the fundamental theorem of calculus, but it assumes that you have a distribution of this shape. Well, more or less.
No, calculus unrelated to distributions, just calculus. The way you.
I would need to
distribution.
I would need to look it up. I've heard it from second hand, not from primary source. Yeah.
It might be the mean value theorem. But
maybe.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. So usually also these distributions are caused by independent events. And these type of distributions are by dependent events. And just like these ones, usually additive processes give you this type of distributions, multiplicative process give you this type of distribution. So instead of simply adding along the mean, if you have a probability of bringing things together or separating things, then you get this type of distribution. Doesn't really matter whether it's log normal or scale-free distribution, if it's perfect or not perfect. If it runs across multiple scales, then it's difficult to simplify. And example is with earthquakes, that they have such a distribution where we don't really care about the mean strength or intensity or frequency of earthquake. We care about the rare events, also called the tail of the distribution. There's not much meaning in the mean. And also, there's a strong relationship between this type of distributions and criticality and phase transitions. So near phase transitions, you tend to find this type of distributions. And we can see also this in terms of balance, but more as a balance towards all scales.
But here, the exponent is close to a half, not one right order.
Well, there are distributions with different types of exponents.
For the earthquakes, you said, okay.
I don't remember what's the exponent for earthquakes. Anybody?
Yeah. Well, half or three halves, depending on how you treat
it. Yeah. So, of course, these type of distributions are harder to study because you need more information, because it's more difficult to simplify. You need to study multiple scales. And this also relates to fractals and 1 over F noise. And, well, they're not so popular anymore, but also in the late 20th century. They were very popular, has its origins in the 19th century with Georg Cantor, and early 20th century, Gaston Julia defined the Julia set, and later Mandelbrot kind of brought it all together. Was it in the 70s? In the 70s? And basically, you have self-similarity with fractals, and that self-similarity will give you distributions where you have few big ones and many small ones, simply because, let's say, the small ones make the big ones. So it's kind of a consequence of that. And of course, all fractals have, let's say, power law-like distributions, but of course, not all power law-like distributions are fractals. And they're prevalent, so waves, mountains, rivers, capillaries, trees, and many others are self-similar. One over F noise, also known as pink noise, it's also related to fractals. In dynamical systems, all chaotic attractors are fractals. And I mean, this like a whole other line of research, but I mean, it's related to these scale-free distributions. And much of this is related with networks. I mean, Euler perhaps was the first one to postulate graph theory in the 18th century. In the early 20th century, in sociology, I mean, there were these sociograms in the 1930s, but they were mainly descriptive, like, okay, this person is related to this other person or organizations. And it was, I guess, after Paul Erdős and collaborators that, let's say, graph theory started to be used to describe complex systems in a more formal way. And they're perfect for studying complex systems because what characterizes complexity is precisely interactions. And with networks, the nodes can represent elements, their links, interactions. And of course, many of you know about the Erdős number, which seems to be still something to be proud of. I don't know what's the Erdős number of the people here, but basically, I mean, he was a very prolific mathematician, so he had hundreds of co-authors. So people who co-authored a paper with Erdős have a Erdős number of one. The co-authors of Erdős co-authors have Erdős number of two, and so on. And this became popular with the Kevin Bacon number, which is basically actors that were in a film with Kevin Bacon have Kevin Bacon number of one. They were in a film with an actor who had Kevin Bacon number of one, then have Kevin Bacon number of two. And curious fact, if you remember from the Wonder Years, the actress that played Wendy, I don't know. she has Erdős number of two because she was also a mathematician and Kevin Bacon number of two, so perhaps she has the shortest Erdős plus Bacon number. Sorry?
Who is this person?
Some actress that people from our generation might recognize. Yeah, that was an actress and mathematician. And of course, this idea of 6 degrees began with Stanley Milgram in the 1950s. I mean, has been formalized in recent times. So, I mean, I'll just show three examples of networks. First of random networks or Erdős Renyi networks. You basically start with nodes and pick two at random and link them. And then you draw in red the largest component. And there's a phase transition when you go from most nodes being separated to most of the nodes being in the giant component. Which theoretically would be here, but because of finite size effects, it's a bit further. So, I mean, it's a phase transition because first the size grows very slowly, and then it grows very fast because you have already components of certain size, so the probability of joining them is higher, and that occurs in very few steps. And once most of the nodes are connected, it becomes slow again because there are some isolated nodes, and it takes some time for them to become part of the component. And I mean, this gives you a random network which has different properties. One of them is that it has a short average path length, meaning that to go from any node to any node, you can do it through relatively few intermediate nodes because it has high connectivity. And this is not the case for regular networks like this one, because here you would need to go all the way around. So Watson-Strogatz, 98, proposed this model of small world networks where they start with a regular network and start rewiring it randomly. And the average path length reduces, but still the cluster coefficient, which characterizes these regular networks, does not reduce so fast. And then in that region, you have small world properties, which is this balance between high clustering coefficient and low average path length. And finally, the Barabasi-Albert model for growing scale-free networks, preferential attachment. You start adding nodes with a preference towards the nodes with which already have more nodes. So this is an instance of the Matthew effect, the rich get richer, which is also observed in many other phenomena. And again, it gives you a scale-free distribution, but then there are many mechanisms that can give you scale-free distribution. This model has several limitations, like for example, you don't have any cycles. But I mean, these very simple models kind of paved the way for what is now network science. You can also see it as another type of balance because you have a few with a lot and many with a few connections. And it has extended in many directions. With a PhD student now, we are kind of starting from this model, trying to model the distribution of stars in star formation. So, I mean, applications are very broad.
Can easily have cycles. For instance, when you introduce new nodes with and make connection to two rather than to one.
Yep.
Cycles.
So yeah, yeah.
It would be three only if you somehow each new node which you introduce it makes just one connection.
Yes, yes. There are so many variations of these models, and then, okay, how do you vary the steepness of the distribution? I mean, it has been lots of work done in this direction. Also, not only adding nodes, but removing nodes or links. There are many things one can do. So, I mean, in many of these networks, we can see that there's structural heterogeneity, meaning that there's no, there, not all nodes are the same as in regular networks. And of course, this has several advantages. One of them is related to Ashby's law of requisite variety. So if you have elements at multiple scales, then you can address variety required at multiple scales. So it's the global airport network, and the size of the nodes are dependent on how many links. So you have a few very large hubs and many small airports. And there are many advantages for having that type of distribution. Let's say making more efficient travel and depending on demand and so on. And I mean, it's relatively easy to see that this is more efficient than kind of saying, okay, all the airports will have the same number of connections, same number of flights, and then try to distribute that in a homogeneous way. And also, if you have multiple scales, it would be easier to match a scale that is unknown or dynamic. I mean, if whatever you're trying to control is shifting among scales, if you have multiple scales, it's easier just to, let's say, exploit a part of the distribution rather than trying to shift the scale dynamically. And also, the structural heterogeneity has a strong relationship with robustness and adaptability. In 10 weeks, I'll speak more about this because we have shown that this structural heterogeneity, but also temporal heterogeneity and functional heterogeneity promote criticality. Basically, for a homogeneous system where you have a phase transition and then you have criticality near that phase transition, you need to fine-tune the parameter like in the Ising model or in random Boolean networks. But we have shown that if you have different types of heterogeneity, including structural heterogeneity, temporal heterogeneity, functional heterogeneity, then this region of criticality is expanded, so you need to do much less fine-tuning. So, I mean, there are many reasons for, let's say, nature having heterogeneity. First, it's simply easier to produce heterogeneity than homogeneity, and having to force all the elements at the same scale, be it spatial or temporal. But it has many advantages for evolvability also to have this heterogeneity, and that will be in 10 weeks. And of course, you can have different mechanisms that produce structural heterogeneity. And of course, it's a book about balance, so it's also everywhere in the sense that it can be used to describe many different phenomena. All the previous examples can be described in terms of balance, in the sense that you have both the advantages of both extremes, like having too much structure of regular networks or no structure at all of random networks. So small world and scale-free topologies can also be seen as different types of balance. So the small world will be a balance between regular and random, the scale-free balance between homogeneous distribution and skewed distributions. Of course, you can have both. They're not exclusive. Of course, there's much more to network science than the few things I mentioned here, in the sense that you can have peculiar cases like redundancy and degeneracy and modularity. But for example, modularity can also be seen as a balance between local information processing and global information processing. And also, we can see balance as a general tendency. And if this tendency is, let's say, more additive, then you will get a distribution that will be slave of scale, basically with a mean, or multiplicative that would be scale-free like. I don't know which kind of distributions you would get with an exponential process. So, I mean, if you have, let's say, bell-shaped like distribution with an additive process, scale-free like with a multiplicative process, I don't know what kind of distribution you will get with an exponential process. I don't know if anyone can think of examples of that. So just to summarize, structural balance is a few big ones, many small ones, and it gives you multiple scales. It's related to heterogeneity. And if we take traditional techniques that will average our distributions, then we'll lose relevant information. For distributions that have a characteristic scale, then we can have the luxury of averaging and just simplifying the distribution to a single value. But when the distributions go across multiple scales, we will lose relevant information. So we need to explicitly consider the distribution. And it doesn't really matter whether they are precisely power laws, whether you can fit them nicely. It's simply whether they span multiple scales, whether they are heterogeneous. And of course, if we include too many details, sometimes it's too much to be following. So the next chapter will be in 4 weeks, will be about rank dynamics. So this is an example of soccer teams in Europe, and there's a ranking, and then different weeks you have different rankings, and then we track how these rankings change in time, and then there's many things you can do about this for any different data set. So that will be in 4 weeks. If there are questions, comments.
Thank you.
Do you have any idea about what would an exponential random process give as a distribution?
What do you mean by exponential random?
So an additive process, basically, you have a value and then you randomly add or subtract from that. Right. That gives you a bell-shaped distribution.
Right.
If you have a multiplicative process, basically, you randomly multiply or divide, then that will give you something like a scale-free distribution. Then if you have a process that randomly you, let's say, raise to a power or take the square root, or if it's exponential, or, I mean, I guess it would be something extremely skewed, but I don't know whether it makes sense or whether there are any instances.
Not that I know.
Very well-defined question, right?
You have to say something about the purgations that you're adding. Why we can take a complicated process and make it more additive process, but just the logarithms. Right, and so in some sense, tell you say a little bit more about what you mean by those things in order to come to those conclusions.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'll just elaborate the what I mean by additive and multiplicative.
Yeah, yeah.
Brief question.
Yep.
Usually, when we see the data, people used to fit the degree distributions to a power law with an exponential cutoff, right? Do you know any model that predicts that particular equation?
You mean the exponent or?
Yeah, the function, the power law with the exponential cutoff. Is there any model that predicts that? Or is it just a statistical approach to fit the data?
Usually it's just fitting the data, how people do it.
Oh.
But then there are also different models for which you kind of try to, with the parameters of the model, then you produce a distribution with a specific exponent.
Okay.
There are variations of the Barabasi-Albert model that will give you an arbitrary exponent.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah. Ten.
¿Puedo escribir la lista? A lo que me refería es que generalmente, esto es la teoría de este grado. Generalmente, muchas funciones de grado, redes de proteínas, redes sociales, tal como tú mostraste, tuve posibilidad de hacer algo con eso.
En log-log, ¿no?
Claro, la ley de poder podría estar también acá.
Sí.
Yo creo que era. Pero el punto es que yo he visto varios artículos, y esto creo que no es un poco. He visto varios artículos que la gente ajusta una ley de poder, pero con un corte exponencial.
Sí.
Mi pregunta es, ¿hay algún modelo que prediga esta ecuación? ¿O esto es solamente una aproximación estadística? Que
sí, es una aproximación, digamos, con algún método tratas de minimizar los errores y vas ajustando los parámetros.
Claro. Entonces, ¿hay algún modelo analítico que prediga esta ecuación?
Es que creo que no es tanto que la prediga, sino que esa ecuación se usa para ajustar los datos. O por lo menos nosotros usamos algo así con estos de lenguajes,
okay.
Con estos datos. Y pues sí.
Sorry, como, I think we should speak.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I just realized that there's someone losing the...
Yeah. So, So let's say there's like a general form of this equation that with the extra parameters, you can fit nicely more distributions.
Okay.
And then Sipp's law, it's just like with say just with the alpha, and then we're using a model with a beta and a gamma, and then you can have one simplified version where you don't vary the beta, and another where you don't vary the gamma, and then another way where you vary both. And
okay, yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a couple of more questions, but we can discuss them later, I guess.
Uh-huh.
So that,
okay. Bueno, el streaming creo que todavía no lo paran, pero...
Una pregunta también muy básica.
Sí.
En esta teoría de transiciones críticas, yo no estoy muy familiarizado con ello porque no soy físico. Esas leyes de poder que se observan, ¿son solamente relaciones empíricas que se observan o hay algún modelo también que prediga que va a existir esa ley de poder después de pasar el punto crítico?
Sí, pues no es tanto cuando lo pasa, sino justo en el punto crítico. Entonces, por ejemplo, en el modelo de criticalidad autoorganizada de Bach.
Ya, yeah. De Bach, ya.
Yeah. Bueno, creo que después le cambiaron el nombre, tiene como que un nombre más general, pero bueno.
Ya.
Yeah. No, Abelian Sandpile Model o algo así, ya no me
acuerdo. Ah, el Sandpile, ya.
Yeah. Entonces, pues ahí como que tiende a la criticalidad, ¿no?
Atiende a no toma el límite en ese punto y ahí se...
O sea, en teoría pues vas corriendo el modelo y pues las avalanchas de, o sea, graficas la distribución de avalanchas y pues te va generando una ley de potencia. Pero se me olvida que cómo es que miden la criticalidad en ese modelo, que como que sí te da criticalidad siempre.
Yeah.
Pero en otros modelos, como por ejemplo el modelo de Ising, pues tienes la fase ordenada donde pues todos se alinean rápidamente en una dirección para temperaturas bajas, y para temperaturas altas tienes, digamos, como equivalente a caos, y pues todos están cambiando constantemente, ¿no? Y en la transición de fase pues tienes avalanchas que siguen una distribución de potencia. Entonces tienes muchos cambios chiquitos que no se propagan, pero de repente se propaga una avalancha grande.
Claro. Pero esa ley de poder se deriva analíticamente del modelo. No es que sea un ajuste estadístico.
Más bien se encuentra empíricamente en la transición de fase.
Ah, ya. Esa era mi duda. Claro. Si se encuentra empíricamente, uh-huh. O hay algún modelo que...
Probablemente haya modelos que...
Ecuaciones y al final...
Probablemente haya modelos que la expliquen, yeah. Pero ya posteriori, ¿no? Así como que ya... A ver, ya observamos que tenemos esta distribución, ¿cómo podemos reproducir esa distribución?
Ah, yeah. Porque la teoría de transiciones críticas o transiciones de fase es una teoría amplia que abarca distintos fenómenos, no solamente respuesta a la temperatura, sino que...
Sí. Sí. Digamos... Como que aplica muchas cosas, pero me parece que no se conoce tanto como debería.
Claro. Claro, porque la teoría incluye cosas como respuestas críticas a la temperatura o distribuciones que dan una ley de poder.
Pero, por ejemplo, tiene implicaciones en economía, en cambio climático, en...
Claro. Ecología, biología. Ajá. Uh-huh. Sí, te lo pregunto porque el modelo que nosotros deberíamos, después de juntar varias ecuaciones, al final lo que yo encontré fue una ley de poder, pero con corte exponencial,
y resulta que generalmente la esta literatura empíricamente tiene esta versión. Pero después hay algo como esto, en reacciones enzimáticas,
diversas variables biológicas. Y nosotros debíamos una versión que de hecho parecía esta, como alguna variable biológica. La temperatura y esto depende exponencialmente de la temperatura y nosotros deberíamos ver lo que le dice esto, que es en el fondo exponencial, pero esto es una ley de poder. Entonces, lo que yo me gustaría evaluar es que en realidad esta ley de poder está explicando esta parte de acá, que es como el decay de las tasas con la temperatura, pero me gustaría poder linkear eso a la teoría de transiciones críticas, porque
digamos, ¿qué es lo que pasa cuando empieza a bajar? ¿Es como una transición de fase o...?
O sea, yo creo que eso es lo que me gustaría explorar más teóricamente, porque nuestro modelo es simple y predice el modelo que publicamos en PNAS. Es simple y predice esto. Pero no tomamos una aproximación muy compleja para predecir esa ley de poder. Como por ejemplo tomar una red y decir que una enzima es una red y después de cierto umbral crítico de conectividad en esa red enzimática, la proteína tiene una transición crítica y se predice esto, no sé. Simplemente obtuvimos esta ecuación y yo